In the early 1990s, a few occurrences sparked something in Ted Chiang's mind. He attended a one-man show in Seattle, where he lives, about a woman's death from cancer. A little later, a friend had a baby and told Chiang about recognizing her son from his movements in the womb. Chiang thought back to certain physical principles he had learned about in high school, in Port Jefferson, New York, having to do with the nature of time. The idea for a story emerged, about accepting the arrival of the inevitable. A linguist, Chiang thought, might learn such acceptance by deciphering the language of an alien race with a different conception of time. For 5 years, when he wasn't working as a technical writer in the software industry, Chiang read books about linguistics. In 1998, he published Story of Your Life in a science fiction anthology series called Starlight. It was around 60 pages long and won 3 major science fiction prizes, the Nebula, the Theodore Sturgeon, and the Seiun, which is bestowed by the Federation of Science Fiction Fan Groups of Japan. Last year, Arrival was released, an adaptation of Story of Your Life, in which Amy Adams plays a linguist who learns, decades in advance, that her daughter will die, as a young woman, of a terminal illness, but goes ahead with the pregnancy anyway. Chiang is now 49, with streaks of gray in his ponytail. He started writing science fiction in high school. Since then, he has published 14 short stories and a novella. By this means, he has become one of the most influential science fiction writers of his generation. He has won 27 major sci-fi awards. He might have won a 28th if, a few years ago, he hadn't declined a nomination because he felt that the nominated story, Liking What You See, a documentary, was unfinished. It imagines using neuroscience to eliminate lookism, or the preference for beautiful faces. Many of Chiang's stories take place in the past, not the future. His first published story, Tower of Babylon, which appeared in 1990 and won a Nebula Award, follows Hillam, a Babylonian stonecutter tasked with climbing to the top of the world and carving a doorway into its granite ceiling. It has the structure of a parable and an uncanny and uncompromising material concreteness. At the top of the tower, Hillam finds that the roof of the world is cold and smooth to the touch. The stonecutters are eager to find out what lies on the other side of the sky, but they are also afraid, and, in a prayer service, Chiang writes, they gave thanks that they were permitted to see so much, and begged forgiveness for their desire to see more. Chiang goes to great lengths to show how ancient stone-cutting techniques might actually be used to breach the floor of heaven. He writes the science fiction that would have existed in an earlier era, had science existed then. Chiang's stories conjure a celestial feeling of a temporality. Hell is the absence of God, is set in a version of the present in which Old Testament religion is tangible, rather than imaginary. Hell is visible through cracks in the ground, angels appear amid lightning storms, and the souls of the good are plainly visible as they ascend to heaven. Neil, the protagonist, had a wife who was killed during an angelic visitation. A curtain of flame surrounding the angel Nathaniel shattered a cafe window, showering her with glass. Other, luckier bystanders were cured of cancer or inspired by God's love. Attending a support group for people who have lost loved ones in similar circumstances, he finds that, although they are all angry at God, some still yearn to love him so that they can join their dead spouses and children in heaven. To write this retelling of the Book of Job, in which one might predict an angel's movements, using a kind of meteorology, Chiang immersed himself in the literature of angels and the problem of innocent suffering. He read C.S. Lewis and the evangelical author Joni Erickson Tata. Since the story was published, in 2001, readers have argued about the meaning of Chiang's vision of a world without faith, in which the certain and proven existence of God is troubling, rather than reassuring. Earlier this winter, I began talking with Chiang about his work, first through Skype, then over the phone and via email. He still works as a technical writer, he creates reference materials for programmers, and lives in Bellevue, near Seattle. I'm curious about what you might call discredited worldviews, he told me, during a phone conversation. It can be tempting to dismiss people from the past, to say, weren't they foolish for thinking things worked that way, but they weren't dummies. They came up with theories as to how the universe worked based on the observations available to them at the time. They thought about the implications of things in the ways that we do now. Sometimes I think, what if further observation had confirmed their initial theories instead of disproving them? What if the universe had really worked that way? Chiang has been described as a writer of humanist sci-fi. Many readers feel that his stories are unusually moving in wonder, given their matter-of-fact tone, where their emotional power comes from. His story, The Great Silence, was included in last year's edition of The Best American Short Stories, and Junot Diaz, who edited that volume, has said that Chiang's Stories of Your Life and Others is as perfect a collection of stories as I've ever read. Chiang himself seems to find this kind of praise bewildering. When, after about a month of long-distance conversation, he is a slow, careful speaker, and so I had asked to interview him again and again, we met for lunch at a ramen restaurant in Bellevue. I asked Chiang why he thought his stories were beloved. He threw up his hands and laughed with genuine incredulity. He had no idea how to account for his